you steal public funds, when you're caught, you say it's because I'm a Muslim, or because I'm a Christian, or because I'm Yoruba or Igbo. That will not work in Kaduna State. We are applying the law blindly without fear or favor. And the fact that they are Christians does not bother me. We'll take down those buildings. The fact that they are Muslims did not bother me when we took down the buildings and Huda College. So all these things, Nigerians should move away from that. Now, as responsible leaders, are we going to sit back and allow sects like this to start, grow, and then we have to use the military to deal with the problem? This thing has happened too often for us not to do something. And I think Air Vice Marshal Usumas of blessed memory began to do something. You know, I have never responded to Sheikh Hussaini's rants and abuses and criticisms because I'm the governor of everyone in the state, and the right to criticize, the right to comment on public policy is a constitutional right. I've never responded to him. I've never commented on what he's doing.
If there are differences, aren't there alternative ways of resolution, of inclusiveness, despite his contrary views? Do you reject a son because he's a black sheep?
No. Look, there are jobs for the party. As you said, he's a member of our party. So it's up to the party to bring him into line or to bring me into line if I'm deviating. That's the job of the political party. And this is why the party has, at a point, suspended him. Because he was not just criticizing me. He was also criticizing General Buhari, our president. He said that his anti-corruption war is selective. He has said things like that, that the party felt it had to do something to bring him into line.
He's entitled to his views. Why suspend him because it's critical of his own party?
I think you should ask the party that question, because I'm not the party. I'm the governor of Kaduna State.
But you're also a leader of the party in your own
right. Yeah, I am. I'm one of those that registered the party, actually. 37 people registered the party. My name is there, but I am no longer playing that role. I am now the governor of the state, and whether you vote for me or not, whether you are in the party or not, I have sworn by the Quran to treat you equally. So I try to not get involved in party issues, whether state or national. I don't want to comment on that.
It's convenient for you not to get involved?
No, it is not convenient. It is actually the right thing to do. I attend party meetings when invited, but for now my job is governor of Kaduna State. And frankly, you know, I do not think that what Sheikh Hussaini is saying or doing is relevant to what I'm doing. I contested elections based on a platform. We have a restoration agenda where I made certain promises, and I'm trying to fulfill those promises. He did not contest on that platform. Okay, he's a senator, and he has his own responsibilities to his constituents. Let him do his own, I will do mine. If he has any advice for me, there are ways of passing that advice to me. But if the way to position yourself for another political office is to criticize me as governor, you are free to do so. We will meet in 2018 and 2019, and the people of Kaduna State will make that choice. This is my view, honestly, and this is what I have told everyone in the Kaduna State government. That's why you'll never hear any commissioner or advisor even speaking about Sheikh Hussaini. Maybe the political advisor, because that's his job to engage with him. But I have prohibited anyone in the Kaduna State government from responding to him.
Because these issues are critical, especially to the democratic process, its evolution. Because if a member of the party has reservations about party policies, government policies, you know, shouldn't he have the right to express himself without being victimized or being perceived?
Look, we have a constitution in our party which governs the rules of membership, okay? And there is a process through which you can disagree with the party. That process is totally internal. Okay, it does not permit you to go public. It does not permit you to go to court until you've exhausted all the internal mechanisms of the party. To the best of my knowledge, Sheikh Hussaini doesn't even attend party meetings in the state. He has never communicated these views to the party through the channels from the ward to local government to state. And if the state doesn't listen to him, he has the right to escalate you to the national level. I don't think he has ever done that. Sheikh Hussaini is not a politician. He started as an activist. Activists live on headlines. That's the oxygen on which they live. And even though he is an elected senator, he has not transmuted to complying with that process. We wrote the constitution of that party. I know the process. He has not been following the process. And this is why the party at a point took steps to discipline him. But he has the right to pursue whatever he wants to pursue, but he should understand that violating the party rules have consequences. And you cannot start saying my right to speak are constrained because you joined the party with the understanding that you'll comply with those rules.
Now let's exit from that issue and progress to another one, which is treading on soft ground, the outlaw and begging in Kaduna State. Now, these beggars say it is a breach on the campaign promises that you made to them before you came to office, that there was going to be a sort of establishment of a commission for them or something, because now that they have been begging has been outlawed, they have no means of livelihood. So is it true? Is it a breach?
No, it is not true. It is not true. When I engage with the disabled, I made it very clear to them that begging is not a profession. Okay? Begging is not something allowed in my religion of Islam. Okay? You're supposed to get a skill and earn a living. Okay? Sadaqa, the giving of charity, is allowed in my religion, is encouraged. But it is not necessarily only to the disabled. There are many ways you can give charity in Islam. Okay? Now, and what I promised them I didn't promise a commission, because I know that I'm inheriting a government that is already overbloated. So we are going to shrink.
So
what we promised was that we will expand our rehabilitation board so that it will take those that are willing to learn skills and will support them, give them skills, train them, pay them a stipend while they are going through training, and give them microcredit to start their businesses. It's what I did in Abuja. In Abuja, I took beggars off the street, but we resettled them. We resettled the lepers in a lepers colony which we got built, and we had schools there so that their children can go to school. They were receiving treatment. The other disabled people, we took them to our vocational training center. We gave them skills. Some were tailors, some were mechanics, some were carpenters, and we gave them microcredit. We got shops for them in Wuse Market and elsewhere so that they can practice their businesses. Some of them are still around. They are still doing it. I can get witnesses. Some, of course, the businesses failed. Some went back to their estates and continued begging there. But this is what we want to do in Kaduna. We do not believe that begging is a profession. We have seen that begging is something peculiarly rampant amongst our part of the country, and we want to put an end to it.
Why not put the alternative in place before you outlaw begging?
The alternative is already there. Rehabilitation board is there. We are in the process of equipping it. We've signed the bill into law. It doesn't take effect until after 2 months at least. And by order in the Gazette, I can postpone it until we are ready. We didn't say stop begging tomorrow. The law says 60 days after, begging will be criminalized. And by order in the Gazette, I can extend it. We are equipping our rehabilitation board. We are bringing more skills there. And we'll give everyone the opportunity to go and get skills, but not to beg on the streets. Now, we are going to establish a fund as well, so that if you want to give charity, you can donate charity, and it will go into the rehabilitation of the beggars, as well as giving them microcredit. We will also allow on Fridays or on Sundays, within the confines of churches and mosques, we will allow for the period, you can go there and beg, but not on the streets. Okay? Not on the streets, not in public places. Only in churches or mosques we can allow that for that limited period, and you can't do that permanently. Okay? because there are people that go to church or mosque with the intention of donating something. We'll allow those that want to do that. But we prefer to have a fund in which anyone that wants to donate to charity can put it in that fund. It will be managed by religious bodies and community leaders so that we channel the resources towards that. Our goal is simple. We want every child in Kaduna to go to school. We are not criminalizing begging just for the sake of it. We want to give people skills, yes, but we don't want the small children carrying them around to miss the opportunity of going to school. We've already made education in Kaduna State free and compulsory for 9 years. Primary school and junior secondary school is free, so you have no excuse. We give each of our primary school pupils 1 meal a day so that we take that burden off the parents. So no one has any excuse not to go to school in Kaduna State. We want 100% enrollment of our girls and boys of the ages of 6 to 15 in schools. This is the objective. So we first made that available, and then we said, okay, no more begging. But I have not even made the law effective yet until we know we are ready. We don't have any bad intentions, but those that are creating stories that I promise this or that are not telling the truth. They even went as far as saying that I promised them 10% of all jobs in Kaduna State. How can I do that? Are the disabled up to 10% of the population? Shouldn't there be some logic to this? But they can say all these things and we'll take it. But we know that as leaders, we are trying to make choices that are in their best long-term interest, and we have engaged with them. We've explained this to them. I have a special assistant on disability who is supposed to liaise and talk to them. But of course, one or two will come out, go to the media and say something completely different. And this is expected in a democracy, but it doesn't deter us from doing what we believe to be right.
You're watching Fireworks. I have been talking with the governor of Kaduna State, Governor Nasir El-Rufai. We've been looking at developments in that state. After the break, we'll progress to happenings at the national level. Stay with Fireworks. We'll be right back. Thank you for staying tuned to Fireworks. I have with me on the program today the governor of Kaduna State, Governor Nasir El-Rufai. In the last half hour, we have sufficiently looked at religion law in Kaduna State. We have looked at developments relating to that. Of course, his relationship with a senator from that state, Senator Shehu Sani. Now we're looking at national issues, and we're going to get the thoughts of the governor on some topical issues that have been affecting Nigerians across the board in recent times. And I'm going to start with the grazing reserve bill. And of course, before we look at the bill, let's first of all look at developments across Nigeria in the last few months. Is it a coincidence that you have attacks or conflicts, as people would want it to be perceived, between farmers and herdsmen happen one after the other in different states of the Federation? Is it a coincidence? Is it normal, like the insurgency which takes place in about three states of the Northeast? Isn't this something out of place?
No, I think that this, there is nothing new in the conflicts between herdsmen and farmers. It has been going on. The difference is this. There are people in Nigeria, there are elements in the political system that have decided to spin this. First to give it prominence, more prominence than it used to have, okay? And to try to attribute it to the fact that it is Fulani herdsmen attacking farmers because a Fulani is president. Is a completely political creation. It is the work of people that lost elections in 2015 and want to escalate this.
But Benue was decimated in 2015, and it was a different government that was at the helm of affairs at the time.
If you check in 2014, in 2013, these conflicts have been going on. If you call Governor Suswan, who was governor until 2015, he will tell you this has always happened. In my state of Kaduna, there have been conflicts between herdsmen and farmers.
So how would it be elements of the past government who are spinning this?
Because they have a lot of money, you know that from the reports of the kinds of money they diverted, and they are playing it in the media. And there are particular newspapers, two or three, that have been given this undue prominence. And these papers, we knew even before the elections, have been PDP sympathetic newspapers. Okay, so I want you to separate the headlines and the spin from the reality. The reality is this: in the last 10 years, since the international stock routes for cattle and grazing reserves have been lost to urban development, to farmlands, these conflicts have increased. Okay, it is a problem. We need to look at it as a problem that is getting out of control, and we deal with it. But to try to ethnicize it, or to try to say it is happening because President Buhari, who is a Fulani, is president, is most irresponsible. Because in my state, we've been dealing with it, okay, for the past 10 years. But it never made the headlines that it is now making. So I think Nigerians should understand that. There is an attempt.
So these issues didn't get prominence during the last administration?
No, they didn't. But they were happening. They were happening. They didn't get prominence then. Because at that time, the biggest concern was Boko Haram. Now that we have dealt with Boko Haram, we decimated it. This...
But towards the end of the last administration, it had generated debates to the extent that people were warning that herdsmen attacks is becoming the new insurgency.
No. This is what I'm saying. It has always been there. Maybe it's got a little bit worse, but the spin around it is reaching new heights because of a government of President Buhari is what I want everyone to be clear about. I can bring you statistics in Kaduna to show that the number of herdsmen farmers clash has been more or less the same in the last 5 years.
Because my worry is this: if you attribute it to the work of elements who are sympathetic to the now opposition party, then ruling party, wouldn't it be an unfair attempt to demonize the past government or the new opposition?
It is not unfair. We have more than perfunctory evidence linking what I'm saying to certain groups and people, but that's beside the point.
It will
be out in time. This is a matter for the criminal law. I don't think it's for the media, okay? But let me say that it is a problem. In my state, for instance, in 2011, during the 2011 elections, the herdsmen were moving from south to north, and they passed by Kaduna State at the time of the 2011 elections, and there was election violence, and many of them were victims. Many of them lost cattle, many were killed, and some of these herdsmen are not even Nigerian. Because this herdsmen issue is quite complicated, because some of them start driving their cattle from countries as far as Guinea, Mali, Senegal, Ghana, Sierra Leone, and come down, because Fulanis live all across these states. Fulanis live in 14 African countries. So they start, once it is the dry season, they pack their herds of cattle and start going through these so-called international stock routes. Okay? And they usually get to the south of Nigeria around February, March, and then they start driving the cattle back once the rain starts, so that they get home by the time it is the rainy season. This has been going on for hundreds of years. Okay, now, as I said, there were international stock routes that they passed. There were grazing reserves. Okay, but though over time, these stock routes have been converted to other uses. The grazing reserves have been converted to other uses into farmlands. And this is the source of the conflict, okay? In Kaduna, we found that that coincidence of herdsmen passing through Kaduna State at the time of the elections, and there was election violence, led to many deaths. And one of the issues I had to deal with as governor of Kaduna State was communal killings in southern Kaduna. Because the people whose cattle or whose relations were killed during the April 2011 post-election violence were coming from Chad, from Cameroon, from Niger, from Senegal to avenge the killings. This is what Fulanis do. Okay? We had to set up a committee led by General Aguay to try to get into the root of the problem. And we are lucky we had a break. We reached one of the Ardos, one of the Fulani leaders of those communities that were doing this in another country. And he reached out to others. So we had a sort of compact. This has to stop. If you want us to pay compensation, we'll pay. If you want us to do anything, but this has to stop. And since then, we've had relative peace in southern Kaduna. Now, there is a problem. And as I said, anywhere you see these conflicts, unless you choose to ethnicize it or blame it on the current government, you can find a solution. I remember when I met the governor of Benue State, I asked him, I said, what happened in Agatu? What is the problem? And he gave me his own insights, which are completely different from the circumstances in my state. The point is this. We should look at these conflicts and try to find out what are the roots so that we deal with them. What we are doing in Kaduna, that's the one I know very well, is that we are resuscitating the grazing reserves. We have about 14 in Kaduna. Some of them have been encroached upon. Only about 4 of them have been gazetted. So we are going to take steps to gazette them. But we are not going to preserve them as grazing reserves, but as ranches, because we want to discourage the movement of the nomads. We want them to settle
in ranches. This suggests that you are in support of the grazing reserve bill.
I have not seen the grazing reserve bill. As far as I know, there is no bill, because I know that it was first presented in the Senate of the last Senate by Senator Zainab Kure, and it was not passed. Okay, and once it was not passed, it has lapsed. If someone wants to revive it and present it, I don't know. I haven't seen the bill. I think it's unnecessary, because at least in the northern states, there is a grazing reserve law passed in 1965, which is applicable to all the northern states. There is a grazing reserve law in Kaduna State, which outlines how to create grazing reserves, how to gazette them, how to manage them. And that's the law we are using to try to get our own 14 grazing reserves, identified, gazetted, but renamed ranch communities. Because people think it's only Fulanis that have cattle. It's not true. There are many other ethnic groups that are in the livestock business that also move their cattle up and down looking for pasture. Now, my thinking, and it coincides with the thinking of my elder brother, the Minister of Agriculture, Audu Ogbe, is if we can provide pasture for the nomads, they will sedentarize, they will stay in one place. Why do they move? They move searching for grass. Now, if you can get a place for them and provide high quality grass and even create an industry that processes cattle, milk, beef, sausages, in one integrated cluster.
We are in a capitalist environment. If you provided reserves for some herdsmen, would you also provide an enabling environment for every other business owner in the country?
No. Look, we are providing ranches and pasture for them to settle their cattle there. Our hope is that once that happens, the milk producers, the yogurt producers will go in there and set up their businesses. We are not setting it up for them. We are creating that enabling environment. We are hoping that the meat processors, the producers of sausages, will go in there and establish a business, okay? We will build schools, we'll build hospitals there, because that's our responsibility. We'll do the roads and the infrastructure. That's our responsibility. It's whether it's a grazing reserve or a village or a town, it's our job to do that. But we have a problem that is leading to the deaths of people, and we have to give it priority. We are not, we create industrial parks, okay, for businesses to site their factories. What is different from that? That's what we are doing for the nomads.
I have read commentary on the bill, and if you have a bill where there is provision for landowners whose land is taken for the purpose of establishing a reserve for herdsmen so that their cattle can graze. But you say that under this bill, you have reservations about your land being taken. You can only apply to the Attorney General of the Federation, first of all, before you can even begin to seek redress in court.
Look, I don't see a stage for conflict. You see, I don't know about this bill. I don't even know whether this bill is constitutional, because I don't think legislation on grazing reserves in the exclusive list. Okay? So the National Assembly looking at grazing, I think they're overreaching themselves, and the states may object, because land is vested in the state governments. You cannot legislate at federal level to take state land. Only the governor of the state can take land and convert it to grazing reserves. The federal government cannot do it. So I haven't seen this bill, frankly. And honestly, as a state governor, I think the bill is superfluous, it's not needed. Because as I said, in the areas where this conflict is potentially the highest, which is the northern states, including North Central Zone, there is already grazing reserve law 1965 passed by the Northern Regional Parliament. So it has been an inherited law by all the 19 northern states unless repealed. So I don't know. I haven't seen the grazing reserve bill. I don't know what it contains. I don't want to comment too much on it, but I have a feeling that grazing is not in the exclusive list. So the National Assembly may not even be competent to legislate on it.
I want to thank you very much, Governor Nasir El-Rufai of Kaduna State. Thank you for your time and thoughts on fire.
Thank you, Bukola.
Talking with the governor of Kaduna State, Governor Nasir El-Rufai. And indeed, we've had a very, very big view, the big picture of happenings in that state, especially on topical issues. And of course, we know that you're armed with the required information. Join us again, same time next week, when we'll bring you another interesting edition of the program. On behalf of the crew, I am Bukola Samuel Wemimo. Bye for now.